A very good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you all very much for joining us this evening. This is the third in a series of talks as part of the Modern and Contemporary program here at the Kunsthistorisches Museum that we are organizing this year. For these four talks, we have invited remarkable personalities from different fields in the art world. We began in January with the Duke of Devonshire, our collector. We continued in March with Philippe de Montebello, our museum director. This evening we have Anthony Doffé, our dealer and philanthropist. And it's a great honor to have you here this evening, Anthony. And in November, we will finish with Roberta Smith, the chief critic for the New York Times, our critic. And we're examining these four positions, if you like, the history of these professions, where they come from, where they are today, and where they're going in the future. I'd just like to begin by thanking our sponsors who make these talks possible. Dom Pérignon. Always feel like I'm on a Formula One podium when we stand up here. The Hotel Sans Souci, and the wonderful group of contemporary patrons of the Kunsthistorisches Museum. So in the week that is dominated by the art fair here in Vienna, I thought it would be appropriate to invite one of the most successful and respected art dealers of recent times. A very brief introduction from my side. The history of art dealing is almost as old as the history of art itself. The moment that art left the side of the walls of caves, it could be bought and sold, and it was. Art dealing existed during the antiquity. It really came of age as we know it now during the Middle Ages, and it was perfected as an art during the Renaissance. All great collections, whether they're private collections or museum collections, were assembled with the help of great dealers. There are no collections on earth that dealers did not have a hand in. This is a wonderful painting which hangs about 100 yards in that direction. It's a portrait by Titian from 1567, and it's a portrait of a rather devilish man called Jacopo Strada, and he was the dealer to the Habsburgs. He was the dealer to Ferdinand I, Maximilian II, and Rudolf II, three of the men who are looking down on us up here this evening, the ones with lots and lots of facial hair. Countless works of art in this museum are here because of this man, this wonderful dealer, who was also an artist himself. The most renowned dealers of recent times have almost assumed some sort of legendary status. This is the American art historian and dealer Bernard Berenson. He was an advisor to many great American collectors, Isabella Stewart Gardner, for example. He built her entire collection. And he worked very, very closely with this man, a British baron called Joseph Duveen, who is arguably the greatest, one of the greatest dealers in history. He coined the wonderful statement, "Europe has a great deal of art, and America has a great deal of money." He made his fortune by buying great works of art from bankrupt British aristocrats and selling them to Mr. Frick, J.P. Morgan, Mr. Rockefeller, so on and so forth. He was also
He also had a great style, which was to say to collectors, you aren't ready for this yet, which is a very good dealer's thing to say to collectors. Persevere, maybe in 3 months, maybe in 6 months, you'll be ready for something of this importance.
He was also a major philanthropist, donating both art and money to the Tate, the British Museum, and a number of other institutions. Anyway, that's just a brief kind of how did we get to this point. The accomplishments of this gentleman sitting next to me stand comparison absolutely with all of these people we've been looking at. A brief bit of biography for Anthony before I let him loose. I've asked Anthony to condense 70 years of life into 24 slides. So it's going to be a wonderfully abbreviated but rich journey through an extraordinary career which is still ongoing and still sort of mid-trajectory. Anthony was born in Sheffield, sort of in the center north of England, in 1940.
Like Pittsburgh. Flames at night. Steel City.
Steel City, industrial heartland of Britain in 1940. He began his career as an art dealer in 1965 at the age of 25, opening his first gallery in London. For the first 15 years or so, he organized mainly historical exhibitions of early 20th century British art. Later in the 1970s, he began to work more with contemporary art, exhibiting artists like Lucian Freud, Frank Auerbach, and Michael Andrews. The gallery that he opened in 1980 on Daring Street, just off the top end of New Bond Street, has since gone down in history as one of the legendary commercial spaces of the 20th century. He set out to bring to the United Kingdom the very best of international contemporary art, and he represented and organized exhibitions by a remarkable stable of artists: Willem de Kooning, Carl André, Jasper Johns, Ellsworth Kelly, Agnes Martin, Joseph Beuys, Jeff Koons, Roy Lichtenstein, Gerhard Richter, Anselm Kiefer, Bruce Nauman, Lucian Freud, Gilbert and George, James Turrell, Sigmar Polka, Cy Twombly, and a chap called Andy Warhol. From these exhibitions, many, many of the works of art that were shown found their way into museum collections. They are works which we all know and see now in the great museums of the world. Anthony closed the gallery in 2001, and we'll be asking him why in a minute. And he spent the next years preparing for an extraordinary philanthropic project called Artist Rooms, which was officially inaugurated in 2008. And that's where we'll be finishing the conversation this evening. Today, he is as busy as ever, overseeing and supporting projects with artists all over the world. So that's a very brief snapshot. And we're now going to go right back to the beginning, and I'm going to ask Anthony, with the help of a few slides, just to explain how you found your way into art, what it was that you were looking at the beginning, and what was the sort of decision-making process between you deciding to dedicate your life to this.
We were very lucky in Leicester. There was a beautiful street without traffic called New Walk, and halfway down the street, this elegant street you can see, there was the New Walk Museum. As a child, it was a place of wonder for me. As you know, the English are mad, and part of their madness is to make the museums free. So it's a beautiful madness. I think we're pretty much the only country in the world where that exists. So as a child, I could go to the museum as often as I wanted, and as often as my mother wanted, because she wanted to go shopping and have coffee with her friends. And instead of having a restless little boy with her, she thought it was a good plan to give him to the nice, kind gentleman behind the desk and say that she would pick him up 2.5 hours later. And I was free then to look at the collections in the museum. Upstairs, there were stuffed animals, a stuffed gorilla, a stuffed hippopotamus, everything you could want as a child, and birds' eggs. On the ground floor, there were wonderful Victorian paintings, and there were also strange and surprising treasure. We had a fantastic collection, small collection, of German Expressionist painting. Only at that time, it was not labeled as German. It was called Middle European because you couldn't speak about Germany. We were still at war with Germany. I was a little boy, and I have to say, believe it or not, that as a child, just about the most fun I had when I wasn't in the museum was when we had an air raid. The sirens were exciting. We went to the air shelter. Mummy and Daddy were behaving rather better than usual and read us stories. And the sirens went on. Bombs fell in our street. Bombs fell on our house. An aeroplane came down at the end of the street. What could be more exciting than that for a boy of five?
And there's a nice comparison you've made here in the slides that you've chosen between something that you looked at very early in your life and something that you came to years later.
There's something about the way she turns. There's something about the palette that makes this painting by Gerhard Richter, which we showed at the end of the 80s, this famous painting, probably his best-known single painting.
I think it's a portrait of his daughter now.
Yes, it's a portrait of his daughter. And it's a picture which we offered to the Tate Gallery. I seem to remember it was $120,000, and which the Tate, sad, unhappy day, did not acquire, and which I, like a fool, sold to an American museum, where it went into a great collection, but which I should have asked the artist if I could buy it so that later on it could be offered to the Tate Gallery again. We did an exhibition of Gerhard Richter's mirrors, and there were one or two paintings of this sort. And to this day, I regret that the Tate Gallery didn't buy it and that I didn't have a good idea. And at any rate, the painting is so famous that Neil McGregor, the director of the British Museum, has just written a book about Germany and just gone to live in Germany. And the painting is reproduced twice, and he thinks of it as Germany turning round and looking at its past.
Albright Knox, where it is now?
No. I'll remember.
Somewhere in America. And Anthony, the next slide, the next two slides you've got are two of the greatest British artists of the 20th century. How early were you seeing the work of Francis Bacon, for example?
Well, I was seeing that as a teenager. And when you're a teenager, you have art classes at school. And you're taught how to paint and what colours to use and how to draw. I was amazed because this picture, and I have to say that the museum in Newark had lovely sofas you could sit on, so you could sit there quietly and look at the paintings and be with the paintings and make friends with the paintings. I thought, the drawing is wrong. The colours are wrong. Why is it so powerful? Why does it make my heart beat in this way? What is the mystery of this? We were speaking earlier about art being the unknowable. I think that's a very good example of art being the unknowable. And how do you know it? How do you get to understand it? How do you get to love it? By being quiet with it. And since I was there for 2.5 hours in the museum on my own, I was able to do that and be with it. And sometimes I would look at the painting, and sometimes I wouldn't look at the painting, and sometimes I would turn my back on the painting and imagine it, or imagine a sort of conversation with it, so that I got to know it very well. And it was a very powerful thing in my life.
And was the attraction to Bacon very immediate? Because, you know, he's one of the most polarizing artists of the 20th century. People find these paintings extraordinarily seductive and utterly repulsive, sometimes at the same time.
You cannot say easily, is this a man? is this a woman? What is happening? What is it depicting? But I did read the other day that during the bombardment of London, that Francis, in the early mornings, helped to pull bodies out of houses that had collapsed and been bombed. And there's something about this picture which suggests that he might be thinking about that right at the back of his mind. I believe it's a portrait of Henrietta Marais, and much later in my life, I remember seeing this girl at a dance and starting to talk to her and realizing it was Henrietta Marais, and then we danced together, and then she took me into a corner and gave me something which made me euphoric, and I thought I'd better not ever do that again.
And you have made this pairing of Bacon with this wonderful painting by Lucian Freud, which we had here a couple of years ago in the exhibition, and a painting which you had in one of your exhibitions at the gallery.
So in 1970, we moved into a slightly larger gallery and made friends with Lucian Freud, who was at the time very much in the shadow of Francis Bacon. And Francis looked after him in an uncle-ish type of way. And it was thrilling, really thrilling, to start to work with a great world-class artist. And we made great friends. And I think after our first show, David Sylvester, the great critic, wrote The Brutality of Fact, interviews with David Sylvester. David said, "I'm really surprised that the paintings have moved on so much." And I think that Lucian is a much more important artist than I ever realized, and I'm going to suggest to the Hayward Gallery that they have a show of his work. And the Hayward Gallery thought that was a great idea. So just within 2 or 3 years of starting to represent him, he got a big show, and that made a big impression on his career. And instead of selling his pictures to the same people, mostly English aristocrats, we started to sell his pictures to museums. And that was a wonderful moment. This painting, actually, we sold to Heini Thyssen. And
he's the father of Francesca Habsburg, who lives here in Vienna. And it's now in the museum in Madrid with the rest of his collection.
And it's a great picture. And it's unlike any portrait in the history of painting.
I actually think if I was given this in a blind slide test, you could almost think this is a painting by Martin Kippenberger. It's got something incredibly modern to it.
Before the fact.
Before the fact. So this is an exhibition of Lucian's that you mounted at the gallery in Daring Street in 1982. Some of you in the audience might remember the painting, which is third from the left, a very small portrait of one of Lucian's children. We had this in the exhibition here a couple of years ago. I'd just like to talk to you a little bit about the gallery. I mean, firstly, just to reiterate what you were saying about Lucian, you started to work with Lucian at a moment that he was deeply unfashionable. He was not the superstar that he is today. Nobody would touch him. You mentioned earlier today that you tried to sell his paintings to people in Germany, you tried to sell his paintings to collectors in America, and there was just no interest anywhere.
He seemed, in a way, Lucian's outside all the standard histories of 20th century art. He stands alone. And as a person, when you were with him, you were immediately conscious that it was as though wherever he was made, wherever his mind was made, it was in a different place from all the other minds you ever met in your life. He was unlike anyone else. He lived this life of day models and night models who under no circumstances must meet each other. He had this low life. He was friends with villains, as he called them. He was friends with the Cray twins. And he was having supper with Princess Margaret. He had an extraordinary life. And you couldn't contact him, only he could contact you. And in a real sense, the people who were close to him fell in love with him. And he became the center of my life while we had this gallery. And in some way, when we opened the big gallery with all these international artists, there was a great sense of loss between us both, because seeing him three times a week was no longer possible because I was traveling, etc.
Some of you might remember that in the last room of the Freud exhibition, we had three monumental paintings of an enormous naked man, Lee Bowery. And Lee was an Australian performance artist, and it was a performance at Anthony's Gallery that Lucien came to see, where he met Lee Bowery for the first time. So it was a hugely important moment also in Lucien's career. And it brings me on to a question to you, really. When I read accounts of your gallery, I see that very early on you were doing publications, you were doing lectures, you were organizing performances, you were organizing private lunches and dinners in the back room for groups of collectors. Now, this all sounds completely familiar now to all good galleries around the world. But then these things were utterly unheard of as strategies within the commercial world. Were you aware that you were sort of going out on a limb with some of the things you were trying to do, and that you were really sort of breaking new ground with the way you were trying to run the gallery?
I think that contemporary art felt so dominated by New York in terms of the museums and the galleries and the collectors. What we tried to do was to make a big gallery. I think there were 8 rooms altogether. So it was like a Soho gallery in the 80s. And to invite the world's greatest artists to come and show in London. We had the idea, what can we do to try and make London a center for contemporary art, so that eventually the place will change and it'll become an alternative place for people to exhibit works of art. And that was in 1980. By the year 2000, Tate Modern had opened a big building. Just a little later, we had Frieze. And by then, London had become perhaps the number 2 venue in the world for contemporary art, and everything had changed.
So another artist who is somehow synonymous with the gallery is Joseph Beuys. As different as you could be from Lucien, you have a man standing in a studio with a paintbrush and a naked person, and you have this shaman-like, performative, mysterious character. I can't imagine that the two of them had very long conversations.
I think they would have absolutely nothing in common. And you can't imagine two more different people. If we started to show Lucien in 1970, Joseph Beuys was the first show in 1980. And he did a great sculpture called Stripes from the house of the shaman, not this, this is Plight, which was 5 years later. Stripes from the house of the shaman, and we had an extraordinary experience with it. It's a big, difficult installation of two rooms. And I thought, what I must do is sell this to a great museum. So I rang up every great museum I could think of and said, we're showing something extraordinary. You haven't got a major work by this great artist. And I got James Mollison, who was the director of the National Gallery of Australia in Canberra. And he was a friend, and we'd sold him one or two things a little bit earlier on. And he was very famous. I'm sure you've all heard of him. He bought for Australia blue poles, which many people think is Jackson Pollock's greatest paintings.
It was an acquisition for the museum that nearly brought the government in Australia down, because it was such an expensive acquisition, and the Australian people were looking at this painting by Jackson Pollock, just couldn't believe that their government had just bought this for the nation.
For $2 million. And he bought two, not one, two Birds in Space by Brancusi. Now, that's an independent guy for you. And so I said to him, you know, this is a great opportunity. The work will sell very, very, very soon. I just think it would be perfect for Australia. It would be great to have Joseph Poyser to come and install it. It hardly costs anything at all. It's a masterpiece. We're friends. You know, I tell you the truth. He said, Anthony, I will believe you, but I shall kill you if it's not true. He believed me, and he was really thrilled with the work when he saw it. And there it is in Canberra today. And Joseph Poyser went out and installed it and fell in love with Australia, as every sensible person in the world does, and did beautiful drawings there. And it was a big part of his life. And then, of course, he trusted me to sell all his other major sculpture to the Guggenheim and the Hirshhorn and Museum of Modern Art and to the Tate. And
this one you sold to the Centre Pompidou, no?
This one, yes. I think we put up rather a lot of the money ourselves, because we thought it would be a great thing to have it in the Pompidou.
So it's 1985 in London. You're just off Bond Street. Nice English people wearing nice English suits with nice English shoes and umbrellas walk into your gallery and they see this. Was there an audience for this, or were you having to create an audience for this?
This was so strange, so unlike anything else, so unlike anybody's experience, that it's very, very difficult to imagine it. The work was called Plight. Plight means three things. Plight means a bad situation, a disaster, a really big difficulty. And that was because we suddenly had the building behind us was being pulled down, and we had colossal noise in the gallery, and we could hardly work. And he said, I love your gallery. I love London. I'm going to make a muffling sculpture for you. So this was the muffling sculpture.
And he soundproofed your gallery.
He soundproofed the gallery. And as you know what felt is made of, it's made of animal's fur and feathers. And it's made from the natural world. And immediately you went in, you felt the temperature. It felt warm. It felt, if I may say so, womb-like. You had the extraordinary experience of your heart beating, and you could hear your heart beating. When you walked around, you could hear for the first time strange noises from your body. And it had the piano there, which was sealed, and the blackboard, the musical blackboard, and a thermometer. It was deeply moving, rather shocking, and a totally thrilling experience. Nobody who ever went in there forgot it.
I'm going to skip past this one, if I may, because I'm looking at my watch.
Yes.
This is a remarkable piece. The German title for this is Blitzschlag mit Lichtschein auf Hirsch. Lightning with stag in its glare. And it's a monumental sculpture in 39 parts by Joseph Beuys, which is installed, I think, permanently, semi-permanently at Tate Modern.
Yes. It's the only room which has been on view permanently since the museum opened in the year 2000.
This is, and how were you involved in this piece, Anthony?
It belonged to Daros in Switzerland. They offered it to the Tate Gallery. The Tate Gallery couldn't afford to buy it. It was going to be returned to Switzerland. We had long talks with Daros, and we found a way that we could buy it over 5 years so that we could keep it in the UK.
Amazing.
And it's part of Artist Rooms.
I'm going to come on to this chap. This is a photograph of Andy Warhol at your gallery in 1986. And before we get on to Andy, because I know him so well, I just wanted to talk to you about this idea of representing artists. I referred to you as an art dealer in my introduction, which is perhaps not fair, because I think you are every bit as much a gallerist as you are a dealer. You took it upon yourself to represent artists, to support their careers, to help shape their careers, to influence their careers, and to shape their legacies beyond. And it's an enormous responsibility. I thought briefly once in my life of becoming a gallerist, and then I thought of this idea of representing artists, and I found this responsibility so suffocating that I just forgot this idea about 5 seconds later. This was a world-famous artist at the time that you began to work with him, and this particular painting that's behind him was something that came directly out of your representation of him and a conversation you had with him. Maybe you could tell us a little bit about it.
When you spoke to Andy and said, would you like to have a show in London? He said, yeah, great. And say, what do you think would be a good thing to show? Oh, Anthony, you choose. You tell me and I'll do that. So I think in the history of art, with all its centuries, no artist has ever said such a thing. It shocks you. You can't believe it. You can't believe that he would trust you. You can't believe that's right, that's proper, that's the way that artists think. But he meant it. And if you look at the catalogue Rizzoni of his work, you see that he did the things which people told him to do. I felt there was an enormous responsibility to do something that was good for his career. That is to say, there had been retrospective paintings, so all the most popular Andy Warhol imagery, and reversals. I think art dealers were trying to find things that would sell. This was at a tough moment in his life, the early 80s. People said the last good thing Andy Warhol did was Chairman Mao. In the 70s, mid-70s, he had a show at the Whitney Gallery of portraits. Many of those portraits were commissioned. People said, this is horrible. You know, he's a has-been. Here, we're seeing an artist in decline. I remember when he did the dollar sign paintings, about 1980, even Leo Castelli hated them, and instead of showing them in West Broadway, he showed them in Green Street Gallery in the basement. Nobody went and saw the show. Nobody liked it. None of them sold. It was a bad moment. And
so you had a knack of grabbing onto these remarkably good, famous artists at the lowest possible points in their careers.
Well, this was a low point. And I thought, I've got to do something that's good for his career. I've got to do something for the history books. And it took me a long time. I was actually with Joseph Beuys at Christmas in Naples, and we went to visit an architect who collected contemporary art. And in his bedroom on the first floor, there was a big red portrait of Beuys, which sort of hit you as you walked into the room. And it was a shock. I thought, my God, this is the greatest portrait painter of the 20th century. How is it that it's 10, 15, 20 years since there's been a great self-portrait? 2 days later, I was in New York and said, Andy, let's do a show of self-portraits in London. He said, yes, that's great. Come back in 5 days and I'll show you photographs. And then we looked at all the photographs and chose. And then we had this great show and sold all these beautiful works. He did say to me, just as I was going out the door, he said, maybe we do some with camouflage. I thought to myself, this is the most horrible single idea I've ever heard in my life. But I didn't say it. I said, oh, Andy, hey, why don't you just do one and we'll look at that together? And I came back again a few days later, and it was the one on the left there, and it looked like a masterpiece. And I felt so ashamed of myself for not trusting the artist. But then we did a great room of these camouflage self-portraits. And at the show, we sold one to the Metropolitan Museum. You can't get better than that. And it really, really meant a great deal to Andy. The pictures sold for $35,000. They now are worth $25 to $30 million each. And it was a colossal success. And we were just working on a new idea. I thought, you know, we have to think of something really good to come out of the self-portrait. Who is the greatest living writer in the world? Samuel Beckett. And what does he look like? Well, he's got a great, great eagle's head. So I put that to Andy, and he was thrilled, and he was in touch with Samuel Beckett, and Beckett thought that was a great idea. And then Andy called me up and said, Anthony, I'm just going into hospital for a couple of days, and then in 10 days I'm flying to Paris, and I'll take photographs of Samuel Beckett, and I'm going to make you an exhibition in really pretty colors. And those were the last words that I spoke to him.
Which is a very nice segue, actually, to our next image. towards the end of the life of the gallery, you began working with a really unique Australian artist called Ron Muick. And this is an artist that we will actually be working with here in Vienna next year for a project. When we were looking at these images, you said it's very rare that an artist, their very first artwork becomes a sort of global sensation. I think Frank Stella, perhaps, is one of the very few who made his greatest works right at the beginning. But this work by Ron, called Dead Dad, from 1996, was something that just launched him into some sort of level of recognition and fame that was extraordinary given how early it came in his career. How did you come across him the first time?
Well, there was a show that Charles Saatchi did called Sensation of the Young British Artists. And that was an exciting show, and it showcased Damien Hirst and all those guys. It also included this artist that nobody had ever heard of, called Ron Muick. And he came from a very poor immigrant German family in Melbourne, and his childhood was spent in the little garage beside the house, making dolls and marionettes to sell in the local market. And he had one of those very shouty type of German fathers who was pretty tough for Ron as a child. And when I tell you that at the age of 17, he discovered he was living beside the sea, you might imagine what sort of childhood that had been, not to know that you were half a mile away from the sea. And his mother-in-law was Paula Rego. He went on to work in making things for films and advertisements. And, you know, I want three dwarfs, 3 foot, 6 foot, and 9 foot in 10 days' time for, you know, advertising, whatever it is. Anyhow, this guy was a perfectionist and an extraordinary artist. And in a show called Spellbound at the Hayward Gallery, Paula Rego, his mother-in-law, asked him to make a sculpture, little Pinocchio, and to stand that in front of her painting. Charles Saatchi saw that, and as you know with Charles Saatchi, he knew a good thing when he saw it, and went to see the artist and bought 3 sculptures for £25,000 from him, and this was the first of them. And this sculpture, which is unique, is a portrait of his father, and extremely moving. It's about half life size, and you could not believe this sculpture was not done from life. In fact, his father was dead in Australia, and this was done in London from the ideas that he had of his father. And it's very beautiful and very shocking and extraordinarily memorable.
There's a couple of other images of works by Ron. There's a lovely one here at the British Museum with a self-portrait.
And just one thing, Jasper. I think that's the artist doing his work. That is to say, I think that his work comes from his dreaming, so to speak. I think there he is asleep, and I think when he wakes up in the morning, he has a clear idea in his mind and makes that into a sculpture.
I've got 2 questions about the gallery that I'd like to ask you. One is, it's staggering when you look at the list of people who used to work for you and what they're doing now. Matthew Marks, the gallerist, James Cohan, the gallerist, Lorcan O'Neill, the gallerist, Sadie Coles, the gallerist, Tanya Bonacta, the gallerist, Gavin Brown, the gallerist, Kirsten Engholm, the gallerist, even the current director of the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York, Tom Campbell, worked for you. Now, this was a systematic program of mentoring, which is unheard of anywhere. Were you aware that what you were doing when...
I think we realized from an early time that that was going to happen, and we welcomed it. We thought we'll have, you know, this very, very bright creative person with us for 3.5 years, and then they'll have their own career. Sometimes we felt like we were a Swiss finishing school or something of the sort, but we tried to encourage all those people to be creative.
To empower them and to take responsibility. And
we gave them responsibility. All the artists were shared between the staff, and it really worked incredibly well.
I think my final question when we're talking about the gallery is a very simple one. You closed the gallery in 2001. What was the thought process behind closing? This has been an immensely successful gallery for 21 years. I was old enough to sort of be there for the last 3 or 4 years, and it was an absolute focal point for all of us in London, and it was just a sort of bolt out of the blue for people who didn't know you when you decided to close.
I always felt that 7 was a magic number, and I always felt that, certainly in my own life, that everything happened in sevens. We'd had the gallery for 21 years. Literally for 21 years, I'd traveled to America twice every month. I was in Europe at least twice every week. We worked round the clock. I think there were virtually no great artists that we wanted to show that we weren't able to show. And it felt like London had changed out of all recognition. And, you know, when you get older, what you long for is another adventure. You don't want, you know, to retire and drink a bottle and a half of red wine every evening and have a heart attack. You want to have another adventure in your life. And so we put together what turned out to be 50 rooms of contemporary art, from Boyce to Warhol, and from Jeff Koons to Damien Hirst. And we made a donation of those rooms to the Tate and the National Galleries of Scotland so that they could travel around the country and be seen by young people in exhibitions that we would tailor for all the museums who couldn't get international shows.
I'm going to briefly interrupt Anthony here because he's being far too modest about this. Between 2001 and 2008, when he 2001 when he closed the gallery in 2008, they put together this collection of 1,000 remarkable works of contemporary art, assembled in individual monographic rooms. 30 works by Ed Ruscha, X works by Via Selmans, works by all sorts of extraordinary artists, and gifted this entire collection to 2 British museums for them to be sent all over the country to provincial museums where they had never even heard of these artists sometimes, let alone had the chance to see them. Free exhibitions with education programs attached to them. It was the largest philanthropic gift in the history of British museums and transformed the understanding of art for young people all over Britain. There's a map which we're going to show you in a minute. We've got a couple of images of examples of these. This is an exhibition of an artist that we also worked with here. I'm getting the feeling that Anthony has been the secret curator of the Kunsthistorisches Modern and Contemporary program for the last few years. I feel like a puppet who's been played for the last few years by Anthony. This is the American artist Ed Ruscha, who was exhibiting in Wolverhampton, where I doubt Ed had ever even heard of Wolverhampton when Anthony picked up the telephone and suggested this exhibition. And now, thanks to this project, there is a painting gifted by Ed to the collection in Wolverhampton that will always be there. And there's a whole series of exhibitions like this. This chap, maybe you'd like to talk about a little bit.
We were very close to Jeff Koons, and it was a great privilege to work with him on this sculpture. And I was also very close to Thomas Krenz and very involved with Bill Bau. And every time we had a meeting, I would say, Thomas.
Sorry, he was the director of the Guggenheim Museum at the time that they built the museum in Bilbao.
Thomas, we are going to put Puppy outside, aren't we? Now, to get a museum to commit to spending $60,000 a year in new flowers and planting is not the easiest thing in the world. But eventually they did, and it is now a legendary sculpture of our time and something that Spain and the Basque nation are very, very proud of.
This is, if you get married in Bilbao, this is where you do your wedding photographs, right here. And in fact, when they had the opening ceremony of the museum, ETA, the separatist terrorist group, planted a bomb, I think, inside the puppy, or very close to the puppy, and there was even a policeman was injured or something. So assume this sort of iconographic level, and Jeff Koons has been an important part of the Artist Rooms program. I'm going to skip past Jeff to someone that I love even more, and I'm looking at Hervig here, sitting in the front row. This is an artist that almost none of you know in Vienna, an extraordinary lady called Via Selmans, and we are going to be treated in the autumn to a retrospective of her prints at the Secession, curated by Hervig. A Latvian artist who emigrated to America, first to the West Coast and now lives in New York. And you've had a long engagement with Via. For all of these lucky people who are going to be seeing Via's work in the autumn, could you say a couple of words about her?
This is a very, very, very strong woman. She left Riga at the age of 6 with the bombs dropping and came back at the age of 75 last year, one of the greatest living artists. And she's enormously tough. One of the things I remember always and whenever I see her about Via is the first word she says, that is, no, she says, no. And you have to get beyond that no to yes, and we managed to get beyond it and have a great exhibition in London of her works and to put this together, and then we arranged a show in Tate, Britain, of her drawings and prints for a year, twinned with Turner. And that's quite an honour for any living artist.
It was one of the single greatest exhibitions I've ever seen in my life. This is an example of the type of work that Via makes. This is a print, silver point etching. You can draw a straight line between her and Albrecht Dürer, just in terms of the technique they're using, but also the sort of fastidiousness of the labor and the concept of time and endeavor. She's been working through basically four motifs for the last 30 years. The night sky, the surface of the ocean, spiders' webs, and the surface of the desert, over and over, and these timeless situations where you have no sense, they're sort of also infinite situations. You have no sense this could have been portrayed by an artist at any moment over the last 500 years. And the exhibition opens in November here at the Secession, and it's going to be one of the absolute highlights of our year in Vienna. And Anthony has published several books with Via, and he informed me today that all of the publishers are now bankrupt because she was so taxing with the printing.
And she's a tough girl, that one.
I went to do a studio visit with her in New York a couple of years ago, inviting her to do an exhibition here, which she declined because she always says no. And she baked me a cake and she made a pot of tea and we sat down on the sofa and I thought, this is great. It's like my granny. It's just lovely. And she said to me, don't get too comfortable. I could put a knife in your back any moment. I was like, shh. Extraordinary artist. And then she proceeded to tell me how Velázquez taught her everything she knew about black and white, how Dürer taught her everything he knew about technique. And I thought, brilliant, Velázquez, Dürer, we're going to do a great show. And then she went, but I will never exhibit in your museum. But I'm glad that Hervig is obviously a far more charming character than I am. We're out of time. We've got a little bit of Damien Hirst.
I always dreamt. Damien used to work for us. We always had young artists working for us, painting the walls, helping us to install, etc. And Damien was just about the one with the best imagination and the best sense of humour. I always thought that a single sheep in formaldehyde called Away from the Flock was a magic work. And I had, when we were putting together artists' rooms, remember that this is the best known artist in the UK today. I thought we've got to have iconic works. So I had to try to find this work, which I found in Berlin, and get it, which was tough. But I felt that Away from the Flock, with its Christian associations, its relationship to pre-Raphaelite painting, I felt that that would be powerful for children and young people. You don't forget it, and it brings up such strong questions of morality and the story of art. And it makes you ask questions about yourself. And it's, you know, been an incredible work to show all over the UK. It's in the Shetland Islands at the moment where we've got an exhibition of his. And this is a very good and important picture. If we have 15,000 visitors to artists' rooms every day, here is just one of them who has obviously spent so much time looking at the Sol LeWitt that her jumper seems to have taken it on board.
And this is just a glimpse of the types of places. You know, you have Robert Mapplethorpe in Wales, Bill Viola in Cheltenham, Richard Long, Dan Flavin in Cornwall, Gerhard Richter in Plymouth, Louise Bourgeois in Southampton, Via, Roy Lichtenstein in Edinburgh, Joseph Boyce all the way up there. And then, I mean, you know, this is a gift in every sense of the word, and it's ongoing, and this is what this busy man is still doing. So, there's a lovely book which Anthony has published about the history of artists' rooms so far. Anyway, we are 7 minutes over time, and I'm conscious that some of you have probably got places to go. Would somebody like to ask a question to Anthony? We have time maybe for a couple of questions. Or we can just do them privately afterwards. We have one question over there. Yeah. I don't know if there's a microphone. Maybe you can just shout. Here's a microphone.
So for young people, how can we get into art collecting? Like, the prices have skyrocketed since the last 10 years. And do you have any advice? Because my mother is an avid collector, and I can go through our house, and in every room there are several contemporary pieces. But, I mean, if you don't inherit a large sum of money, how do you get into collecting?
Well, I remember in my own case that when I was a teenager and I went into a cafe and there were some pictures there, it was very exciting to know there was a young artist there. And I certainly wanted to make friends and to, you know what sort of a life artist had. I always think that to be a great artist, you need enormous amounts of courage. And I wanted to know what it could be like to be an artist. And I think that if you care deeply about art, you've got to care about not only old masters or artists of your own time, but young artists. And young artists need a lot of encouragement and a lot of help. And remember in my own case that, you know, to buy somebody a whiskey and to buy a sketch from them for £5 was an exciting moment for them. So I think there are all sorts of ways of encouraging artists, but I think it's our duty to do that always.
In terms of how on earth does one collect without money, I would say if you're wearing a pair of trainers which have three stripes on them, or a pair of trainers with a swoosh on them, each one of those pairs of shoes is a work of art, which you could buy. Go on to Amazon and order a film called Herb and Dorothy. It is one of the greatest films ever made about a man who worked in a post office in New York and his wife who was a librarian. And they built one of the greatest art collections in the history of the United States. They took his salary every month for living off and her salary every month for buying art. Post office and library. Seriously blue-collar jobs, and they built one of the most remarkable collections ever. It's a deeply inspiring film, and yeah. And they were if you can afford a ticket to a museum, you can actually afford to do the Rundgang and go and buy a work from a young artist in one of the art schools in Vienna, absolutely. Most of the art that I buy costs me more to frame than it does to buy. So it's very possible. Even poor museum curators can do it.
They were called Vogel, the collectors.
Herb and Dorothy Vogel.
And they were both tiny, and he had a habit, he always used to say, I'm just a small collector. And they were like...
Watch the film. They stored the art in the oven under their beds. They said their bed went up about 5 centimeters every year because they were just ramming art underneath it. And this was Sol LeWitt, Lawrence Wiener, everything under there. We're going to wrap up. I'm just going to tell you about the three next things as part of our modern and contemporary program. On the 19th of October, we open an exhibition dedicated to an artist that you've probably never heard of, an extraordinary American artist called Joseph Cornell. We've spent 4 years preparing this exhibition. It's currently in London at the Royal Academy. It will be packed as of Monday next week and travel to Vienna. It opens on October the 19th. This is the second in a series of exhibitions that we began with Lucian Freud. I love Lucian, as Anthony does. I'm even more excited about this exhibition. So come back and see this. This will be our main show in Salle 8 all autumn. We have a number of talks later this year. On the 16th of November, we have the chief critic of the New York Times, Roberta Smith, and an even greater critic, in my opinion, her husband, Jerry Saltz, the critic for New York Magazine, one of the most outspoken people you will ever meet. They're coming to talk with me about the history of art criticism, where is it today, and where on earth is it going in the future, and all the problems that are facing criticism today. And as part of the Joseph Cornell Rahmen program, we've invited a series of amazing figures to come to Vienna and talk about their love of Joseph Cornell. And I'm delighted that on the 15th of December, Orhan Pamuk, a Nobel Prize-winning author of the Museum of Innocence, is going to come to celebrate Joseph Cornell's birthday. Mr. Cornell is no longer alive, but to celebrate what would have been his birthday and to come and talk about his love of Cornell. So there's all sorts of things happening through the autumn. All that remains for me to say this evening is thank you very much to Dom Pérignon, thank you to the Hotel Sans Souci, thank you to the wonderful contemporary patrons, thank you to all of you to coming, but most importantly, thank you very much, Anthony, for being so generous with all your thoughts this evening. Thank you.